it's good. It'll have another new
one. Okay, welcome everybody. Let's talk racing. Yeah, we have Colin, Kay, and Scott in the house with me, Roger, on the other side of the camera. Thank God for y'all.
We're just keeping Al's seat warm tonight. That's all.
Scott's keeping Al's seat warm. He's down in Charlotte playing around. Anywho, we're going to go back across what we've already been discussing.
NASCAR news and...
For the Periscope people that have already been out there listening. NASCAR, of course, has kicked the chase into the next two levels. Can you imagine if they do that for the everything else?
K&N's next.
K&N.
Oh, no, well... Hey, do we have 16 cars in a K&N race?
I'm not Almost.
Okay, you've all made the chase.
All right.
When you get eliminated, you don't come back to the track. You missed the last race.
But anyway.
That's your NASCAR car.
NASCAR is, Xfinity and trucks are now going to have a chase format. A little bit different, but the trucks also get a caution clock. Why do we need a caution clock?
It seems to me there's enough debris on the track on a regular basis where I don't remember a race lasting more than 20 minutes without a caution. So
anybody out there on Periscope, tell us, why would they need a caution clock? We got to have somebody who knows something out there.
Now, you look at some of the, like, and this is not Truck Series either, but California and some of these places where it's just lap after lap, and like, is that race still on? You know?
Yeah.
Some place like that, I guess I could see where you might want a caution clock, but... I mean, that seems like that could also cost these guys more money, right? Because don't they want to come in and get tires every time they come in?
The trucks, you're limited to the amount of tires.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
And I think Xfinity's limited, too.
Oh, and how about the new crate motor rule now for Truck Series?
Oh, they do have a crate motor?
They're going to crate motors now this year.
Oh, man, that was something I suggested 6 years ago.
So now trucks are going to crate motors.
Me and actually a couple of cup drivers I talked to. Thought that'd be a good idea.
Well, maybe that'll pay. The savings will pay for the extra tires that you need with all the cost.
Save on the crate motors. How much are they allowed to mess with it?
I'm not sure. I just saw where the trucks were going over to crate. We're switching to crate motors this year.
For those people who might be watching, like me, does that mean the engine comes in a crate for everybody has the same
Everybody has a standard.
It just means that you can't tamper with it as much as you would like to.
They call it a crate engine because it actually, yes, they normally ship them in a crate, but it comes from one manufacturer.
And you can't mess with it.
And they're all set the same.
Yeah. So regardless of what manufacturer of chassis you're driving,
you get the same engine.
Everybody has the same engine.
So it's kind of like the Craftsman IROC series.
I mean, there's some of the Saturday night racers, racing tracks that they have, local tracks, they will have a crate engine rule. And they will specify where you buy it. Well, I mean, for those guys, the engines were only $1,500.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And when you figure, when you race in a weekly race, you pay $500 a set of tires. And you do one engine, you can run the whole season on one engine. So these guys here, the Truck Series, I don't know. I'm sure it's not going to cost no $1,500.
Right, but I mean, it'll still help them out, though, cost-wise.
Yeah. I mean, then...
It'll save them some money.
Yep.
For new truck, for new chassis and stuff like that.
They won't have to worry about renting engines, theoretically, I presume.
And I think that whole Team Alliance thing, I think the Cup Series, I think they're still trying to do that. That whole Team Alliance.
Yeah, but I don't know if it's based. Well, I think that was more to help keep costs down by going to a hotel and say, okay, instead of 20 people here, 20 people there, we're going to have 300 of us want to go book your room. You know. Mm-hmm. So.
You know, the caution thing, though, it makes me think about when the NFL started going to broadcast games, and so they had the
TV timeout.
Yeah. Media. And so that's basically what it is.
NASCAR
because,
is going to now.
Yeah, you can say to the...
We can put more commercials in.
Well, no, but
that's what racing needs, is more commercials.
Yeah, right.
You can say to a specific time, your commercial is going to air at this time frame, as opposed to you're going to have the fourth
We're jamming commercials in. I guess that's true. Yeah. So.
Yeah.
All right, more Peyton Manning commercials during the race.
What is it, Napa commercial? We'll watch that same commercial 400 times
within
one race. I mean,
like the truck racers. the chase begins with just 8 drivers. Rounded down to 6 after races at New Hampshire, Vegas, and Talladega.
Okay.
Before the four determine.
3 and then a cutoff?
Huh?
3 races and a cutoff? 3
yep.
and a red cutoff?
Yeah.
Okay. And the final, will it come down to a final 4?
Yes.
For the final race? Okay.
That'll be after the next 2 races at Martinsville, Texas, and Phoenix.
All right.
Then you have your final 4.
It would be interesting, though, to kind of be the fly on the wall when the discussion was taking place. Like, what's
he probably
the
flew
goal?
Away.
Yeah, no, probably got bored.
But you're shitting me. I'm out of here.
I think
the goal for NASCAR?
I think they're just grasping at straws because their TV ratings are down, the track attendance is down, and they're just throwing at something at the wall to see what sticks. And so that's.
And plus, they're still taking out seats from different tracks, too. They're still taking out seats.
Yeah, so I don't know.
Yeah, they're still.
I guess they'll be the first to know if it works or doesn't work.
What are they going to do when they get down to 10,000 seats at some of these tracks?
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe it'll be like the old days, right?
They kind of just finished building that whole new thing now.
We get back to where people are sitting up on the dirt hill at Bristol.
Yeah,
they
kind of just finished building that.
Yeah, and Talladega's was new this year, too, right?
All right, well, before we run out of time, let's talk about your boy, Tony.
Okay, well, it's only 6 minutes in, but we can go ahead and talk about Tony. Tony, back in the news again.
Had an altercation in the stands, I guess.
With a drunk cop.
Somebody had too much to drink, and...
The guy was flipping
must
him
have
off.
Called Tony by his nickname, I guess. Which I don't know what...
What's the name of that be?
I don't know. It must have been one that he did like.
Tony's called... Smoking!
Yeah.
Oh, jeez. Anyway, but a drunk cop was flipping Tony off and telling Tony a few things once he got up close to him about he didn't like him and all this other stuff. And apparently Tony just pushed on him and the guy fell over. And
they started off and they were talking in each other's face and then they were doing a little wrist wrestling, you know, kind of grabbing each other's arm and stuff like that. And then finally Tony just gave him the quick little shove. Wasn't enough like a full arm extension that would have really pushed the guy back. But as soon as Tony had touched the guy like that, like this, then the other guy next to Tony was like, okay, have a seat.
Time for you to sit down.
Yeah.
I don't care
before
if you're
things get out
of
hand.
It's probably a good thing you didn't have a gun with him.
Well,
like a taser.
I would guess most cops do have a gun with them, wouldn't you think?
Probably.
I mean,
they
have a concealed...
They're not supposed to.
Yeah, if they're drinking, they're not supposed to, yeah.
Well...
But, hey... Do you know any cops that don't break rules?
What is what is their
don't
little,
answer that.
I'm not gonna say.
I was just gonna say, what is their little fraternal order of police bar that they have? So I'm sure they're not just sipping Pepsi in there.
Yeah, I mean,
a little too dark for Pepsi.
In theory, you're a police officer 24/7, and you should be armed 24/7.
Okay, well, maybe not when you're at their own club, I guess.
We'll have a shootout.
Maybe
we'll have a shootout at the FOP.
Yeah, maybe he was working undercover at the Elks Lodge that afternoon, just before he got to the Chili Bowl. So he was trying to blend in with the rest of the people.
Oh, jeez. But
he had to have a picture.
Media's been all over it, just tearing it up left and right, you know, and just, of course, doing what us media people like to do, blowing it out of proportion just so they'll have headlines.
Yeah, well.
Yeah.
You know.
Interest in
just for something to read about.
I'm sure at some point that's probably going to cause Tony to go off on somebody again.
No.
Has he released a statement after it?
Probably not. I haven't heard anything.
But just think, now that it's his farewell season, think of all the great gifts that people can give him.
I know.
Speaking of that, Joe
Boxing
gives
gloves.
Speed bag, speed bag.
Hold on. Yeah. Anger management.
Anger management discounts.
Yeah.
You can get a
treasure ball.
Here's a savings card for the next anger management class.
Now there is one nice thing. Joe Gibbs Racing is going to honor Tony throughout the season.
Oh, they are? Okay.
For his racing that they've done with them and help bring them up to the next level.
Okay.
You mean like with a...
They have a little Tony Stewart
Maybe they'll have a little Tony Stewart bobblehead doll in the front of the car doing this in the camera.
Oh, what do you think of all the new digital dashboards that the Cup Series is running?
No. Oh, I'd like to see them.
I like it. The digital dashboards.
Yeah. I'm waiting for them to get caught up.
I'm starting to get into Formula One now.
They're getting the Formula
One. Getting close.
Yeah. But, I mean, next thing you know, it'll be the shift paddles on the steering wheel.
Hey, I wouldn't mind that. Shifters. Paddle shift. Nice. I mean, it'd be a lot quicker when the restarts.
Something.
Yeah. I mean,
keep some kind of connection to the old days.
What?
Yeah.
Stick shift.
Stick shift.
Who drives a stick shift when you do a paddle shift now?
Really, I mean, and then the whole steering wheel just pulls right off with all the...
Basically, everything you need is on the wheel, just like a Formula One wheel. Everything's right there.
It's always good.
That'd be good until there's, as usual, electrical problems in a car.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
That'd be fun.
Remember...
The gauges go dead on that situation.
We're going back to Tony Stewart. Remember when he did the fuel injection? Mm-hmm. One of the first races had fuel injection, and the fuel injection system died while he was in the middle of a race leading it. He wasn't happy, you know that. Mm-hmm. Would you be?
No.
Not even.
So if we're going to borrow stuff from Formula One, why don't we get rid of the slicks and race in the rain?
Yeah, but I am. Start and get a hard compound and a medium compound and a soft compound.
It would have to depend on the track. I mean, you can't...
Like four different
you can't go high bank track.
That would drive Goodyear crazy, having to recreate
four different tire compounds. Yeah.
They have enough problems as it is.
They can't get one right. Oh, God.
What else happened? Anything else fun?
Oh, I don't know. I slid away from the screen, so I can't tell.
Truex got Bass Pro.
That's his new
sponsor. Biffle
got KFC.
Oh, okay. KFC, that's what they're
at least for Daytona.
Brian Scott's with Richard Petty now. 44.
Okay.
Notice they're not running number 9 anymore, so that's probably going to go there with Chase Elliott here soon.
Maybe.
He's
really worried about running this.
Yeah, and he wants to bring it over. I mean, Hendrick might just buy it anyway.
It seemed like to me he would have wanted to make a name for a number that somebody hasn't run in a while. You know, it doesn't have to be his dad's or Jeff Gordon's number.
I noticed they changed up the number 24 just a little bit.
25 or something.
One of the things that I thought was cute was when Jeff Gordon started appearing on with the sports thing, with him being an announcer and everything, they had the 24 car behind it. And Chase Elliott was saying, you're not part of that car no more. What are you doing with the picture of it? You know? So that was kicking out there a little bit for a while. People just want to kick up some stuff. Mm-hmm.
Not a lot going on.
Fans are worse than media is sometimes.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And what do you mean?
Kicking stuff up.
Picking and picking
that
stuff.
Well, look at Tony Stewart. Media wasn't on it until the fans were on it and bring it up. Then the media had to jump in.
That's people with
they're looking for something.
Yeah.
Really. They're always
too much time and not enough rain.
Although, I have to be honest,
they're a race car driver.
Season of sports right now.
Yeah, they need some filler, that's for sure.
Not a lot to watch.
Yeah. Well, that's what they come watch us for, right?
You mean not everybody's really glued to the TV watching the NBA? I can't imagine.
I know. Or NHL.
Or I'm missing out on Australian Open.
Oh, tennis, yeah.
Well, it's nice, though, that it's been on ESPN, too.
Yep. On the Tennis Channel and ESPN2.
Although it seems whenever I flip to watch the tennis, it's the commentators talking to each other. There's like no tennis.
Well, usually commercial.
It depends on what time of the day you're doing it too, because you got to remember they're like hours different.
Yeah, they're tomorrow.
Us.
That's true.
So that's a whole different thing.
It's already morning right now. So does in Australia, isn't it?
Yeah, 18 hours. I think
we're gonna do a sports shift. What'd you think about all the big timers getting out real early in the first round? Venus.
I don't follow it well enough.
Is Venus a big timer?
Yeah, she's ranked, fifth, right?
No, Serena.
Venus. So Venus was out.
Venus already's been knocked out?
Venus was knocked out. Nadal.
I didn't think Venus was a big timer anymore.
Yeah,
I
mean, she's top 10.
She can't beat her sister, so what's the difference?
She used to.
Well, yeah, when her sister was like 20, maybe.
Must have one of our callers already. That should be Greg Everett.
Let's talk racing.
Is this some driver or something knows how to run late models or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, you got that little championship statue somewhere in there. I remember seeing somewhere on Facebook.
Feature winner stickers.
Yeah,
one or two of them anyway, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
Go ahead and introduce yourself, Greg, and do a quick bio so some of the people out there know a little bit something about you.
All right, hey, I'm Greg Edwards. I am five-time champion at Langley Speedway. We drive an Eagle 97.3 Chevrolet, sponsored by Danny's Glass. And, just glad to be here.
Short and sweet. I like
that. To the point.
So, you already got your stuff lined up for this year?
Yeah, I'm pretty good. We've got a new car being built as we speak, and we've got the other car. We're working on finishing up. Everything's going on. Motor program's coming along. We're pretty much done with one motor. Other motor's being finished up. So, Yeah, we're ready to figure out where we're going to be racing. But, yeah, of course, we're ready to go.
And that was my next question. Where are you going to be racing at?
Well, I'm still fairly convinced we're going to be racing at Langley Speedway. I just, I have a very positive attitude about that. I feel for certain Bill Mullins will work something out. I believe he's four drivers. And, I know he's working on his arm. I know him as a friend. And I know he's I'm sure he's working with that. So I'm not going to worry about it too much. I mean, if something terrible were to come up, we probably maybe hit Old Dominion or the Dominion Speedway or South Boston. But we're not going to worry about that when it happens. But my own track is Langley Speedway. I want to go there.
Yeah, we'll keep the positive attitude. We'll be out there at Langley this year.
I think everybody should. I think it'll be just fun.
Now, how long have you been racing at Langley?
Well, I started racing I've been racing at Langley. I started racing the go-karts there in 1987. And we started racing Grand Stocks. It was kind of like a limited car back then. We just started driving that in 1990, and so I've been racing late model stock cars since 1990, and we've done other things. We've dabbled in the ASA division and moved around, done a few other things, a couple of nationwide races or bush races at the time. So, we've done a few things, but my main thing has been late model stock car. That's what I love.
Yeah, when you were doing the nationwide let's see, what was it back then?
Bush Series.
The guys that you had sponsored on the car, that big old bright yellow car, are they still even around?
Yeah. Livermore Windowfilm is still big in the industry. They're probably still the biggest in the windowfilm industry. So, pretty much anybody that knows as much about, windowfilm or window tinting knows who Livermore Windowfilm is. They're a very big company. And they were, at the time, out of Martinsville, and it was a good... we had just started a window tint business ourselves, and we kind of got in connection with them. That's when Danny was doing the Bush Series, and they joined up with him, and that was a good deal. And I think after they left Danny, they sponsored Philip Morris for some races, and they went over to some other teams. So, they went around. They're a very big company.
Cool. Now, how does it feel racing almost week in and week out against your brother?
I'm pretty used to it by now. I've been doing it for 20-plus years, but we pretty much got it down where we don't aggravate each other too much. We race each other hard, but, I think we got it down where we don't lose any sleep about it, and there's no trouble with Thanksgiving dinner or anything.
I was going to say, family get-togethers, you ever have ones that are a little tense or anything?
We've been doing it this long, so if we haven't killed each other yet, we're all right.
Any risk of the wives going at it?
Well, that's different. The crews and stuff like that might be a little different, but between me and them.
Now, I noticed your dad, because I've always run into him sitting up in the spotter stand or something. How does he approach talking with you guys when it's race day?
He does. I very rarely talk to him. He'll come down there and he'll say, he'll get the radios and hit up, but he spots for Danny. And, he pretty much lets us go. I mean, my dad's the type that'll tell you what you did wrong after you did it, but he's not going to. He's pretty cool about it. He knows we know what we're doing.
Well, good. Yeah, you guys have been around for a long time. I mean, you guys were racing before I did and still racing after I left. So. As long as you guys are having fun and keeping it a family feud down to the minimal.
it's not a problem. And these late model stock cars, for anybody that hasn't watched late model stock cars or haven't raced them, I love them. I feel like the competition's always been great there. And, I just love the way these cars are. I love short tracks. It's just something that... I'm at a point in my career where I'm happy. I'm happy with, running as good as we do in the late models, and I have fun doing it. The pressure's not like it would be, say, if I was driving a truck or anything like that. My sponsors, and we have good relationships with them, and, we go there and we have fun. The crew has fun. We're strictly volunteers. We do it because we love to race, and, we love winning.
Mm-hmm. Good deal. And of course, you're hoping that it brings in a lot of good advertisement for Danny's class as well, and 97.3. Yeah,
it doesn't hurt. Over the years, I believe that's helped our business. You know, we've kind of branded ourselves around Danny's class and the racing. And Eagle 97 has been with me a long time. They've been on and off, but, you know, we've been through four championships with them now. And, yeah, those guys are awesome. They're really they're easy to deal with. And, yeah, I hope we're helping them out some way, too.
When you started going 97.3, and of course, you changed your car number over to 97. You'd been 27 for so long. Any feelings on that, having to give it up?
Well, I always feel like I'm 27. I still wear a necklace that says 27 on it, but, you know, sometimes you got to do things for the sponsor, so 97's all right, but I always feel like that. But if I were to do my own car that wasn't affiliated with them, I would definitely would be 27. I feel like that's my, I don't know, that was my first number, but number's a number. I can't see it from the windshield.
Put a little 27 somewhere on the car nowadays or something.
Yeah,
usually
we'll keep a small 27 on
there. Yeah. You going to be racing in the next Denny Hamlin race whenever it is?
Well, I mean, yeah, I'm sure I will, but as far as I know, there's no Denny Hamlin race this year. I think that thing's been totally canceled.
Yeah. Well,
I'll do it. I love
that
race. It's a good time.
Yeah, Buck had sent me a thing. People that had already been invited for this one will automatically be invited for the next one. So if you're already invited, you're there for the next one too then.
Yeah, well, I hope so.
All right. Hey, Greg, this is Colin Brown, local legend car driver here in Virginia. So,
Hey, man. Hey, Colin.
So what advice would you give to someone about to run their rookie season in a late model? Like, what they need to know that they may not already know?
Basically, if you're coming out of Legends, you're going to be pretty good about car control, because those cars are kind of, you know, power to weight ratio. They're similar to the late model. The biggest thing you're going to have a hard time getting used to is the weight. The cars are, they go fast, and by themselves, they handle real good, but when you get in a pack of cars, sometimes things happen really fast around you, and a lot of rookie drivers have a problem driving over the hood. And it's hard to get that out of your head because you're doing everything to keep the car in you, but just stay calm in the car, breathe, and look ahead. Look ahead. Be a defensive driver. I mean, just the guy that drives offensively all the time, that's got to be sitting on the record most of the time. be really defensive the whole time, and don't try to be the person that doesn't say, I got to win the first race, or don't let crew and other people put too much pressure on you. Do what you can do to work yourself up so you're comfortable.
I've got a question for you, Greg. I'm going to see how good your memory is or how little it bothered you. You and I were racing, and Bufkin was racing. You guys were coming up on me, and all of a sudden, you wound up in the turn three wall. I got blacked. Do what?
I've been in that wall three times, but I don't remember. But
anyway, I wound up getting black flagged for putting you into the wall for rough driving. I pulled the car into the pits. What?
That's the only time I'm doing the track. Usually I feel like I'm the black sheep of the racetrack. I feel like the calls usually don't come out late, but I don't know why they would have to do that. I mean, we're all in there trying to race, and it doesn't matter which position you're in, everybody's trying to race, and it's our job, if you're the leaders, to get around that traffic, and none of that bothers me. I mean, everybody on the racetrack deserves their spot, and you got to negotiate around. The track shouldn't really, unless somebody just blatantly crashed you, that doesn't bother me at all.
Well, the thing that got me was when I pulled in and I got out, I raised hell with the officials. I said, look at the right side of my car. There is not a dent. There's not a tire mark. There's not nothing. And Bufkin was the one that actually got up behind me and slid to the right and tapped you in the rear and spun you out into the wall.
Yeah. Sometimes, unfortunately, especially back then, we didn't have any instant replay, so I guess the wrong person's in it. But I've been on your side of the stick, too, where I didn't touch somebody and they're yelling at me and black flagging me, so I don't know what you do. It's their ball, we just play with it.
Yeah.
So you've been at Langley for a long time. How have racing personalities changed over the years? And do you feel like you get respect from everybody? And was it better back then than what it is possibly now?
I don't know. I mean, you got so many young kids with a ton of talent always coming through, and you got veterans. When I started, we had veterans like, you know, Phil Warren, Mike Buffkin, Bo Fairfield, my brother, you know, Roger Sawyer. There's a list of probably 10 or 12 cars you could win any night. And I feel like that is maybe better racing with those guys back in the day. You know, we could have tracked and raced with Barry Bagley, Wayne Patterson. You know, it was tough, but it is tough now, too, because now I feel like I've gotten to the level where I'm those guys, and probably somebody like you that's coming in, you're where I was. So It's no different. It's just always evolving, but it's always the same. There's always personalities. I remember one of the great personalities, a great friend, you know, he was to be passed now, but T.J. Johnson was just, he was a trip. There's always somebody like that. I mean, now you got people like Nick Smith. You've got personalities you out there that, you know, It's still the same. It never changes. It's always evolved.
Do you remember, Greg, when some of the guys actually carried guns in their race cars with them?
Yeah.
That'd be a mistake.
What was the purpose of that?
Oh, that was really bad.
Taking pot shots and going down the road?
Shoot the tires out.
That was the case somebody really got pissed about something. Because back then, it was a lot of money you spent. Granted, it is nowadays, but it was less sponsorship back then.
Yeah, more personal money.
Yeah, more personal.
Yeah, I mean, you still have people with big money, and, you know, I don't know, it's just, it's all the same. I remember back then, ship busting always had the big money, and you guys had a lot of money, and, you know, they thought the Edwards had a lot of money, which I guess in comparison to then, we did have some. Now, you know, I try to deal with very little money. As a matter of fact, James, usually, I try to win enough races and do enough on our own where James makes a little bit of money every year. It's not a lot, but he keeps his racing going without having to go into his pocket too much. So that's my goal every year. So if I can keep him racing without him breaking the bank, then I'm happy.
You got everybody stumped, it looks like. Mm-hmm. I start sending out a message and it goes quiet.
Yeah.
I know this is going to be a hard question for you. What do you think was your most challenging race you've ever had out there in Langley?
I don't know. Well, so far it's been the Anthony Heat, honestly. There's no one race. It's every one of them. I haven't been able to grasp that thing. I mean, I really want it. And, that's a tough race. I don't know why. You can win all the way up to the Anthony Heat, but once that race starts, just crazy things seem to happen. So that's one. Another one that sticks in my mind is years ago we started a 400 lap race out there.
Oh yes.
And they were like in the middle of July, it would be like 90 degrees.
Pontiac.
No air in this course back then. And I mean, you're talking about a wore out, and then the 400 lap race, you didn't even know which corner you were in. You were just kind of delirious in the car. But yeah, that was a pretty tough race.
Can't imagine that.
When the track got resurfaced and everything, and they took away the little drop-off point in the turns, where everybody used to drop their tires down and get a little extra grip going around the turns, how did that bother you when that started happening?
Well, I found something around there. You see, Dick Johnson was the first one that I noticed it, but you would hang the left front tire kind of half off the racetrack. And it kind of reminded me of this, make the car grip up almost like the old Le Mans car at the Busch Gardens, where it would just lift the corner. And you had to purchase on the wheel to do it, but it was worth about 2/10. And when they did that, they put rumble strips down there and took that away from us. And now this is the rumble strips, and there's an apron. And, you know, I try to use that apron the best I can. I think did you ever watch CJ? I mean, you have watched, sitting on it, the 40 car, who watched Philip get around there. He was really good at using that apron. And, you know, if you can get your car to turn on that apron and get down there on it, there's definitely some speed there. A lot of people don't like the way it feels, but to me, I like it the shortest way around. And, you know, there's a million ways to get around that racetrack, but you got to do what feels right for you.
Do you ever find your car sometimes runs better on the outside groove than instead the inside groove?
Yeah, of course. I mean, and 2 years ago, the outside groove was where it was, and Matt Walsh seemed to be the one that had that figured out better than anybody. But yeah, it got to where everybody be moving up. You know, the bottom grid was no man's land. You most restarts, if you're on the pole, you're going to start on the outside and just you keep your momentum. The track had lost some grip on the bottom, so nobody can get off the bottom. So yeah, it happens a lot. You know, if the bottom grip goes away, where anybody can get off the corner, you can jump up in the top grid and make some time.
All right. Well, let me go ahead and let you give a shout-out to your sponsors again and let you go ahead and get out there and maybe next time get you and Ashley out here live with us and go out and get something to eat afterwards.
All right, sounds good. I'd like to thank Danny's Glass, 97.3 The Eagle, Fair Distributing, Charlie and I Racing Engines, Creek's Race Cars, and James Long for letting me drive his cars.
Awesome. All right, well, we hope to see you out at Langley this year. Lots of wins in the front places of everything.
Hey, we'll be there, man.
All right, talk to you later.
Okay, thank you. See ya.
Bye. All right. Yeah, I was so pissed that night. They had a caution. I went from my pit. I walked across the track. I went up and... Butch Lassiter was the head official back then. There's a friend of mine, too. I went up there. He said, now, PC, take it easy. I know you probably didn't cause that. I didn't cause it. Hell, look at it. I started going about that side of the car again. Oh, my God. But anyway, it was already over with. And...
So what's the... I hadn't heard about Langley Speedway, so...
Langley Speedway is up in the air as to whether they'll be opening back up. The lease has not been renewed, and the track has not been bought. They want Bill Mullis wants to buy the track.
Oh.
From the two girls that own it that live out in California. So that's what it was last year also.
Uh-huh.
So they did a 1-year lease extension. So now...
They don't want us. The owners don't want to sell, or they want someone else to lease the track. Or
well,
what's the
value of the property is this much. They want this much.
So have they raised the cost of both the lease and the purchase price?
I don't think they.
Are they willing to sell if you gave them what they wanted?
Right now, I don't even think the lease is out there offered yet.
Okay. So it's up for sale if somebody wants it.
Yeah, if they want to pull it out of their pockets. Mm-hmm. So, and it's like almost twice as much as what it was worth.
Mm.
Because they want to use the land for something else, or?
Who knows? I mean, they're not here. They just want the money. They live in California. They own other properties that they get lease payments from. The trailer park to the left of the track, that's all.
Is it all the same parcel?
Well, no, it's split, but they own all of it. They can split it how they want.
So they don't have any affiliation to racing. They just own the property.
They just own the property. And it's actually a sublease. Used to be Henry Click, who passed away, so John Click is now the main leaser of it. And he's got like a 99-year lease on it or something like that. And so they were leasing the track to whoever wanted to run the track.
Okay.
And so... I was just getting ready to text Ray.
That's all, Grayson.
Yeah, how you doing? My name is Brett Huggett. I'm a long-time fan of Langley Raceway. I'd like to put in my 2 cents worth about Langley, if I could.
All right.
Go for it.
Yeah, man, I've been out there at Langley for a long time, and I love the races going on. I hate to see that they're not going to be there this year. Do you think there's going to be any racing going on Langley this year? I love going out there.
The thing is, there still has not made a decision been made. So yeah. I'm still being told positive thoughts that it will be back out there again in full force.
Man, we are really looking forward to going out there. Me and a lot of my friends, we have about 15 guys that go out every weekend. Sit in the stands, and we root for the Eagle 97 car. Greg Edwards is our favorite fan. He's our favorite driver. Back when he was 2.7 car, it was always go 2.7, go 2.7. Now we've changed to go 9.7, go 9.7. And it still fits. It sounds good. And man, as long as Greg's behind the wheel, that's our guy. That's who we
Well, thank you for calling us and giving us your opinion.
The positive side of it is, if you're a big Greg Edwards fan, something doesn't go well with Langley Track, you'll be a fan of the final driver that won a championship there.
Yes, love it, guys. Appreciate y'all's show. Y'all do a good job.
Thank you for calling in, and keep watching.
Okay, thank you.
All right, bye.
That was fun. Hey, there you go. Start taking some calls from the public, you know?
Yeah. Hey, I've put the number out there. And I've had people say, oh, yeah, I'm going to call in. And they get scared. Get a little chicken thin, boy. Mm-hmm. I tell you.
Is that this one?
Yeah. Right here? Yeah.
Let's start
racing.
Hey, man. It's Ray.
Hey, Ray.
What's up, guys?
We're actually going to be really doing it this time instead of like last week.
Oh, I'm excited.
What did we talk about last week? Let's do that again.
Replay. So how's everything going? You're getting to play with the Xfinity now, I hear.
Yeah, definitely. Getting to move up on there, and I'm excited about that. Actually just got up to North Carolina right now, and meeting up with the team tomorrow morning, and going over some plans and looking at the new cars we got in, so I'm excited to get this thing rolling.
So how did all that work about?
Yeah, you know, it's taken a long time. You know, we weren't expecting to go to Xfinity so fast, but, you know, everything kind of worked out, and some circumstances happened where we just had a big opening. We had to either jump in it or just kind of sit on the sidelines. So we chose to get in there, and, you know, the team is busting their butt, and, you know, this is a big step up from where they've been and where we've been. And so it's taken on pretty good, and, you know, I'm ready to get to Daytona, man, and I'm tired of waiting.
I forgot to have you. Go ahead and introduce yourself and do a quick bio so some of the new listeners will learn something from you.
All right. Well, my name is Ray Blake, Jr., and last year I raced the NASCAR Camper Truck Series in the 07 Scuba Lab Chevrolet, and this year we went up to Xfinity Series with the Camaro, the 07, also the same paint scheme, so... Yeah, I'm excited, man. We're going to take a step up, and we'll look the same doing it. So it's going to keep that reputation of the look going, and it's going to be pretty cool to see.
Yeah, how's scuba life liking that?
Yeah, man. You know, it's huge for a sponsor like that. And, you know, they want the best for their company, and they know and they understand that if you want to get your name out there, you got to put in some more money and put in some more time, so that's what they're doing, and I think we can put a good on show for them. You know, we got Scuba Life and Commercial Diver Academy and NASA Worldwide, and they're all diving affiliated, so, you know, we can get out there and train some fans, be some scuba divers, and they'll go dive with me, so it's going to be a good year.
I tell you, that works out. Do you like all that scuba diving? You got the sponsors to help you out there with it, too.
Yeah, no, it's a win-win for me, that's for sure.
I'm surprised Jay's been spending time off down there scuba diving since down there in Florida area.
Oh, yeah. I do a ton of diving, man. We go to down to Key West and Key Largo and go down to Jupiter, Florida and all those places, man. You know, even go to the island, you know, Bahamas, St. Kitts, things like that. Just stay busy. And we also have a spring in Ocala. You know, so we're always diving, you know, whether it's for working or for fun. So that's a huge part of my life. And it's been good to me so far, that's for sure.
To be off a little bit off the racing thing, but on your sponsor thing, where do you find some of your best diving that you do at?
That's a good question. You know, best diving, I don't know. There's so many great places that I haven't been to yet. That's one thing I'm looking forward to is getting to the new places. And I love the Keys, though. You know, it's a great atmosphere down there. Everybody's laid back. Island life, but it's still connected to the mainland. So you got your things that you usually have up here, and it's just fun down there. It's a good time and a good party, and also a lot of good diving, the lobster, and lots of good fish and sharks we see. So it's a good adventure.
You had much run in with sharks?
Definitely. I've had my fair share. You know, at the end of the day, they're not too mean. They're just big fish looking for some food.
As long as you're not on the menu.
They fight for it. Yeah, they're just looking for easy meals. So, you know, as long as you don't bother them, they won't bother you. And, you know, they mind their own business for the most part. But some of them do get curious sometimes. So sometimes you just got to hold your own.
Here, let me chew on him, see if he's edible, and then I'll spit him out.
Yeah.
What do you think about having a chance to put your car in the chase this year.
Yeah, I seen that. That's pretty interesting. You know, the top 12 get in, and yeah, that's going to be really exciting for them. You know, last few races and to get in the chase, and I'm hoping for a top 15. That was my goal, and top 12 fits right in that little category. You know, it's just right in the middle. So you never know, man. We could have a stellar year and just everything. You know, the moves line up right and all that good stuff, and we could be sitting 12th in points, and you know, underdog gets the chase. I know it's a tall order, but hey, you know, I've seen crazier things happen. That's for sure.
Well, I'm sure going to miss running into you at Martinsville.
Yeah, I know. That's one of my favorite tracks. You know, like getting in down and dirty and beating bang with each other. And that's a great track. We've had some good runs there. So, and you know, Eldora, too. That's one thing I'm going to miss. Not a fun little track, too. So there's some things that are going to change, but do a lot more racing. So that's the upside of it.
How much has running in the Truck Series helped your team prepare cars for the Xfinity Series, data-wise?
Yeah, definitely a lot of data coming over, you know, especially from me, you know, what I take from each track, and then they kind of conform to my setup and how I like to race and things like that. So that's a huge benefit, you know, having the same driver and the crew chief with Jason Miller and Bobby, and then they can just kind of transfer a lot of stuff over. And we just recently got a pull-down rig, so had a bunch of notes on that, and that's going to help tremendously. Just a small thing like that, and you know, obviously the Xfinity is the new thing for all of us. And we did one race with me last year, and then they did a handful more with Jimmy Weller and Tom Bodine. So, you know, they have a little experience, but, you know, I'm looking at going in there with a clean slate and just going out and knock some top 15s and top 20s out. And, you know, I think we'll be really competitive once we get into a groove.
Yeah, I think at the last Richmond race, I remember seeing the sponsor on the side of a trailer, and I sitting there started looking for you.
Oh yeah, no, they were using it, but no, I wish I was there, man. Trust me, if I would have had the opportunity, you know me, I'd have been right in that seat.
Oh,
so I was going to ask you a diving question since you've been in Florida.
Mm-hmm.
So a while ago when I lived in Florida, they had, if you free dove, you could take as many lobster as you wanted. As long as you took male lobster. So
yeah.
When you're, do they still have that? Is that still open season?
That's a good question. I don't know the answer to that one. I know, like, for scuba diving, you know, you get six a limit.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, if you go back on shore, you can grab a bunch off and then come back and do it. There's ways around all that stuff. But I don't know. I mean, I don't think you could, you know, they might not have a limit on free diving. But, I think they might, you know, because they're starting to get strict down there, you know.
Right.
Because they have, like, a bunch of commercial fishermen, you know, taking advantage of the situation and kind of overdoing it. So they might have changed it a little bit, but I know they're really...
Still there? Oh,
you go.
Cell phones, I tell you. You hit that before it starts making the other noise.
Before it starts getting louder.
Yeah. All right, where is that? There we go.
So how much, will he get any testing time, any extra time being a new driver in a new series?
If they pay for time somewhere, maybe. I don't know what the rules are. Do they limit testing and there's just certain opportunities for Xfinity?
Well, when you're a rookie in there, you do get a little bit more practice at the different places, so I'm sure that he's going to get some of that, but when he calls back in just a moment, I hope he calls back in a moment, considering his time was just about out anyway. I wonder if his phone died.
He might have.
Incoming.
Yeah.
Is that you, Ray?
Hey.
Yeah, you were talking about your limit on the lobster and all that, so, and right about that time, it sounded like a lightning bolt had hit your car or something.
Probably. It's crazy up here.
Yeah.
No, I enjoy a lot of stuff there, you know. I know for scuba diving, they get limits and, you know, 6 per day and all that stuff, but that's fun down there, getting free diving. And usually when we're free diving, we go spear fishing a lot. You know, that's one of our main things we like doing. So I know with a lobster, man, I have to have a spear stupid set on because I'll be passed out. I know, man, those suckers are fast.
Yeah, they are fast. And when you're spearfishing is when you see your sharks.
Yeah, no, that's when they come out, yeah. When they get a big meal, they always come out and stick things out. It's fun, it's interesting.
Yeah, they refer to that limit around here. People like to rock fish, and there's a limit on that, but they refer to that limit rule as catch, fillet, and release.
Yeah,
go ahead and ask your question, Ray.
So, Ray, when we lost you on the phone, I had a question. As a new driver in a new series, do they give you any opportunity for to get some experience on the track or some testing or anything like that?
I know the they give you probably like I think two test sessions as a rookie, but you know, I don't think we'll be involved in any of those because you know I take a lot of money.
Right.
And if last year we tested or the year before that was the only test I've actually done and it was like Gateway and. You know, I wouldn't mind testing, but they make it, you know, really expensive, get rent the track, and, you know, sometimes you'll find another team or two that's doing it, and you kind of split it with them, but for the most part, I think we'll be pretty set. I mean, we'll have a lot of races, so I think, you know, just once we get into your rhythm, you know, there's not really any track that I'm, like, totally going to be used to, you know. I've been to a bunch of mile and a half and short tracks, and just one hurt for us, so I think we'll have a good handle on a lot of things, hopefully.
So what about the NASCAR game? Are you gonna spend some gaming time to get more familiar with the tracks?
Yes, ma'am. I just got a new iRacing simulator. So,
very cool.
I got it hooked up, and I've been spending a couple hours a day on it, and it's been really helpful. Just getting the visuals on the track and things like that, and you know, just sit in the seat. You know, I mean, it definitely helps a lot, and you know, I'm glad I got it. Especially just killing time in the off season, that's for sure. It helps a lot.
Did you get a simulator with hydraulics and all that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I did it. It's an experience. So, just got the whole track package and free TVs and all that good stuff.
Wow.
There you go.
Who made your simulator?
SimRacer. Sim Experience.
Okay.
They're pretty good. They're up in Ohio. So
you sell time in your iRacing suite there?
Yeah, right. Yeah, come on down.
Rent it out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's funny. Yeah, I say that. All my friends come over and they get on it more than I do.
You should charge them for it.
Yeah, I might start doing that.
Put a coin slot on that thing.
Put
some coin slot on that thing. And
like they do in the vibrating beds, you know, put a slot machine there.
Yeah, right. You better feed it some more quarters, like doing your car wash. Starts beeping with 30 seconds to go, you better put some more quarters in there.
Hey, it could pay for your racing career.
Yeah, exactly. I
could pay for the simulator anyway, over time.
Yeah, I'd like that.
Oh, good. Oh, what time is it here? Oh, sorry, past this time. Let me go ahead and let you get out of here, Ray. And we'll get back up with you later on. Hopefully, we'll run into you in Richmond sometime or some other places. Never know.
Yes. Yeah, I'm glad you had time to talk today. I'm glad you got a big fix. And I'm looking forward to talking again, that's for sure.
Yeah, even whether it's racing or scuba diving, we'll have fun all the way around.
Hey, just let me know. You want to go diving? I'm the man.
Send me the address. Text it to me.
Okay.
All right. Talk to you later, bud.
Good luck.
All right, guys. Stay safe. See you later. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Ray's a nice guy. He's nice, energetic young kid. We had fun up in Martinsville. We went down there and talked to them, and I said, come on, I'm going to take y'all out for supper. And no, we're going to take you out for some. No. Finance, okay, third time the charm, y'all win.
Was there something on his bio about he and his father, is this their business? The scuba something or other? Or are they
no, I don't think it's
anything
their
to do with that? Or?
Yeah, because the way whenever I talk with him, it's always the sponsor. It's not
okay.
My dad's business or something
okay.
like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like Menards or...
Okay.
Yeah. I was thinking, though, there's some great PR stuff that you could do because so many tracks have lakes.
Yeah.
So you could set up a fan experience.
Yeah. Or scavenger hunt.
Maybe there's some cars still out there in the lake at Daytona.
Go to Daytona, yeah.
We lost the driver. We never found him. Mm-hmm.
They do a little fishing contest there at the lake.
They do. They have fishing
contests. Some of the little stuff.
That'd be fun to go fishing and see cars come screaming by down the back stretch. You're in practice sessions.
What
would
the fish do?
I'm sure they're used to it.
Yeah.
I wonder how NASCAR, which they may have already been doing this anyway, but I wonder how they'll start potentially using the drones for coverage in any way, if they can get away with it.
Every 10 minutes
or exactly, you know, how that might affect how they try to cover the race.
The drone thing, that's kind
of, I mean, if you're flying it, say, in the turn, but the, you know, where it's kind of just flying over top of grass.
Nails the drone down.
No, but it's just flying like over the grass, maybe. I don't know if they can get away with it in some way or not.
It's all the, you know, the conductivity between the drone and the controller. There's so much telemetry with the NASCAR stuff.
Probably so, yeah.
Most of them are on 2.4 gigahertz.
I thought it might be the new Digger cam. That's what I thought.
This
is the bug. We call this the bug cam.
Remember I think it was the pigeon they caught with the race car, and it just went poof.
Yeah, that was Earnhardt that hit the pigeon.
That'll be your drone cam.
That's your drone, yeah.
Poof.
It's the bug game.
I can't remember what race it was, but it was Harvick was on the radio, and a cat ran across the racetrack right in front of him, all the way across the track.
Yeah, there was a rabbit or something coming out of one of the drains at
the worst I've ever seen.
What track that was?
Wasn't there a deer run across the track?
Pocono. Yeah,
Arizona. They tagged a coyote.
Oh really?
Wow!
It was shoved so far up in there, it was into the engine.
Oh wow!
It just went right through
the engine. Where did they get on the track?
I guess it smelled really bad in that race car.
Trying to get out.
You see him in the. I grew up in Arizona, and you see him in the parking lots.
Yeah, they're all over the place.
Oh okay.
Yeah. Don't bother people.
They're scavengers.
You don't really bother people that much.
Not like adult-sized people.
Yeah, they're just.
I wouldn't send my kids out there.
Yeah. They're just like free feral dogs, you know, running around, just collecting.
Take them in the house, you know. Yeah. Try to have a pet kind of thing.
That's if you.
Yes, come here, my little kitty.
I love that
commercial with the raccoon.
What are you doing outside, you rascal?
Oh, sometimes I have to send an email to somebody. Or we're just going to keep on talking.
You waiting on Dominique?
Waiting on Dominique. Where you at, Dominique? Shame on you.
All right, well, what other news did we not touch on? You were talking about, Jay Jr., he's calling in, right?
Yeah, he's calling in today.
Oh, okay. Are you trying to do an extended show tonight because Al's not here?
We're doing 8 to 8. We're getting all the way to 8:15 this time.
Oh, wow.
All right.
See, at 8:01, Al says, all right, it's time to eat.
Yeah, Al is watching his clock.
Yep. Unless it is somebody that he wants to really keep talking with. We have gone beyond 8 o'clock if Al's got somebody he really likes talking to.
He liked the NASCAR artist. He talked to him
Harry Hill
quite a bit.
Yeah.
Which they already knew each other.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sam Bash would probably have to be another one, good one to call. Yeah. I'm still wondering when to do Tiger Tom again.
Oh, I like talking to Tiger Tom.
I saw him on American Pickers
today. American Pickers episode.
Yeah, he was on that episode.
I still haven't seen that episode yet. Damn it.
It was on today.
What is he having that they looked at?
He had, I guess, they pulled up at his buildings
down there.
You know who Tiger Tom is?
He has multiple buildings.
His name is Tiger Tom Pistone.
Pistone, they say.
Pistone.
Tiger's all I ever call him, anyway. He has been around late racing since, before I was
early.
He's a big
mid-50s.
He's a big legend car guru.
Yeah,
he was in it in the mid-50s racing at Soldier Field.
He was part of
Chicago. That's where he grew up. He's apparently drove a vegetable truck or something like that.
And
decided to put a car in the races at Soldier Field.
Yep. And so he was also part of the group that helped get NASCAR together. And he's been around forever. He loves Legends cars.
He's a big Legend car guy.
Big Legend car driver.
Bandoleros.
He likes building them, working with them, helping the kids out, and all this other stuff. And he's got tons of friends in NASCAR, and he's got millions of great stories.
Sure.
I mean, it is awesome that some of the stuff he can come back through.
We fill in a whole hour just with him.
He's got a heck of a warehouse down there.
Yes.
I guess that's his farm or property.
Or,
yep.
No, he's from. I guess it's outside Charlotte.
I have to look up, but he's down in the Charlotte area.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's got a huge place. You go in there and it's just big commercial shelves full of stuff.
He didn't throw away anything.
No.
I mean, and if somebody else threw it away, he picked
it
up.
Got it.
Yeah.
He's his own picker,
basically.
I remember Dale Jr. talking about one of the driver's kids that he would hang around with at the track. And, you know, they didn't pay any attention to the races going on. They just kind of, like young kids would do, just seeing what they could get into. But he said after the race, teams would leave boxes of stuff laying around, and they'd just all gather it all up and take it back to, you know, I guess his dad's trailer or something like that. And he said people used to throw away a whole box of, brand new box of bubble glasses. You know how they had the open face helmet before?
I mean, look.
They'd find stuff like that around the track. They just, you know, collect it all.
I mean, lug nuts. Lug nuts are one use only.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
On the car. When they're done, it's off. And
I picked up my 10 pounds of lug nuts. Yeah.
I'll tell you my lug nuts story later. But they have a lot of stuff. Used to be sheet metal. You can get sheet metal all over the place and just cut it off and leave it. Mm-hmm. You know, they weren't going to reuse it or anything.
They didn't think about selling it in the gift store or anything
and
at the
nowadays,
time.
So
now,
you get the whole side of a car.
Nowadays,
for free.
Charity.
It was just trash. Hey,
you've been in my kitchen room. You see what's up there, right?
Uh-huh.
I got a fender of a car.
Yeah.
So.
There's unlimited souvenirs you can buy down there at
Stuart
Haas. Yeah, they have. Lots of the 10 car down there.
They're probably going to have new cars.
It's not cheap either.
I know.
You think about it, but some of the stuff they sell,
$100.
The pieces they're selling, you know, it's not cheap. Well, now hers is a little less expensive than when you go over to Hendrick and you start wanting to buy a piece of Jimmy Johnson's car or somebody's car.
Yeah,
it's a little more pricey.
One of the pistons out of one of Stewart's engines with an autograph on that.
Okay, that's cool.
So, I got tons of stuff at the house.
I'd like to have the whole side of the car. That would be cool.
Yeah, the whole one.
I figured that'll be my retirement fund. I'll just put it all on eBay one day. A couple of weeks anyway.
Reminded me of a recent local story. Did you see it was on the news? It wasn't too long ago where Chris Lemons had found his father's car, the car that he was actually killed in, at a bar in Virginia Beach.
Yep,
was hanging
up. I remember a little bit about that.
Wow, isn't that unusual? How that could ever be found? But it was, it was kind of just hanging up as decoration in the bar, and somebody had seen it maybe and sent him a picture, and come to find out, it was the actual car.
Number 11.
Did the bar owner know that?
No, they had no idea. I don't know where they got it from or how they got it.
They probably just got it from somebody that.
I don't know how they got it.
But it was an actual car.
But they ended up giving it to him. So
that was
pretty crazy. Well, I mean, it's just a sentimental thing, I guess, to have. Because they just had lost touch with that car, I guess.
They never knew what happened. Come to find out,
it's, you know, hanging up as a decoration, so he was able to go over and get it back. So.
Hmm. That was one of the nights that I wasn't at the track, and that was back when I was at the track almost every race back then.
Yep.
Well, I reckon we're not going to hear from Dominique. I'll have to send Chris a nasty note about that.
Well, she can't call at 8:15 because we got to eat.
Yeah.
I'm in Al's seat tonight, so it's my responsibility.
Leave at 8:15.
At 8:15.
I'm going to text J.A. and tell him to call.
All right, Roger. Let's get out of here. That's what he always says. All right, Roger, let's get out of here.
Is it time to go in yet?
Getting
hungry now.
Where are we going, Roger?
All right, let's see here. Beer.
Oh. I got to get home before the blizzard hits tonight anyway.
Is it going to start tonight?
It's supposed to be some flurries.
It's cold enough.
We hung up on them.
Oh. They come back.
I think they hung up on us.
Well, now I'm going to have to go home and read all this news that I wasn't paying
attention to. Go ahead and call.
Yeah, that's been a little bit. You can Google the Tony Stewart thing.
You can read for all the snow.
You going to eat with us this time, or do you have to...
Nah, I gotta go home and feed the kids.
Well, they're gonna be starving by then.
Yeah, we had cinnamon rolls at like 4 o'clock.
Oh,
really?
Yeah. So they're gonna be expecting pizza
entree.
Are we having Domino's?
No, it's
pull up tonight.
Grilled ham and cheese is the new favorite.
Let's all racing.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, I got a joke for you. Hope you don't mind.
Okay.
call a dehydrated Frenchman?
I don't know.
A croissant?
Croissant.
What do you call him, Pierre?
There you go, I like that.
Alright guys, have a good night.
Alright.
I gotta remember that one.
Let's talk racing.
Hello, it's J.A. Jr.
J.A., long time no see.
What's going on? Happy New Year.
You too, bud.
How's everything going?
Oh, it's going good. I see it's even going better for you now.
A little bit. But same old, same old.
Go ahead and give everybody a quick bio about yourself. Introduce yourself so that the new listeners will know somebody.
Well, hi, everybody. My name is Tyro Avila, a.k.a. J.A. Jr. I'm from Miami, California. I'm 20 years old. I'm currently racing in a NASCAR K&M Pro Series with Red Racing and stuff, so hopefully it'll be a good year.
Hey Jay, it's Colin Brown. Congrats on your Rev Racing Draft for Diversity opportunity.
Hey buddy, thank you so much. That means a lot.
So the team you're with has really good equipment. So do you think you can be able to hang with the HCOT cars? And
it's gonna be tough. But I think I met with all the guys this week and stuff like that. I was hanging out the shop with them, and they're really pumped. You know, they got really brand new cars and stuff like that. One of them is my car. They're really trying new stuff. They learned a lot last year races and stuff. They won the last race with Colin at Dover. So, I mean, it's going to be a good year. I think we can be up there with the driver lineup this year with Ruben Garcia with winning the Mexico Series and stuff. And then Colin Cabri winning the last Dover race and stuff. So, and then me along with all the information we got, I mean, it will be pretty strong this year. I wouldn't be surprised if we got a few wins this year.
How did testing go in Daytona with the ARCA car, and what was your impressions going full speed around the track?
Oh man, Daytona, that was so much fun. I mean, going at 200 miles an hour, getting like those 9-car pack drafts. I mean, testing with the Lira cars. I mean, those guys do a phenomenal job. I shouldn't thank Carlos Lira and Michael Lira. That's an amazing group of people. And I wish, we'll see if I can race the February race. That'd be pretty awesome if I can. So we're still working on the flusher this stuff, so we'll see.
Do you plan on running another series outside of Canaan and ARCA? And how do you...
We're trying to do a few ARCA races this year, so I really want to focus on that Canaan series. That's the main priority right now, but if anything else, probably ARCA.
Have you relocated to North Carolina, or are you still in California?
What's that? I'm in North Carolina right now. We got everything settled. Moving out here next week to Kannapolis, so it's gonna be fun living out here in Charlotte.
All right, cool.
Well, we'll have to get you to take and do a day trip. Come up here and play on the show one day.
Oh yes, of course. I would love to do that.
I tell you what, we definitely enjoyed having you here for that show. We had a blast with you. You know that.
Oh no, you guys are awesome. Thank you so much for having me on the show tonight.
Oh, no problem.
Oh wow.
So what's the thing you're most looking forward to for Florida?
For Ethan Irma?
Uh-huh.
Oh man, me and my crew chief were talking about that. I mean, mm-hmm. If we could get finished in the top 10, have a good solid night up in there, I think that would be a win for us. I mean, that first race would probably just with me learning the crew chief team, how they work and stuff like that, and move on, learn, get a feel for how the team works and stuff, and then the second race, I think we'll really hit it off and start going for wins and hopefully a championship.
Are they still having a K&N race at New Smyrna?
Yes, sir.
So we're going to see you as the winner of New Smyrna, right?
Pensacola.
Well, yeah, well, that's the first race up in New Smyrna for the K&N East series, so...
Are you planning on going to Daytona too for a Canaan race?
We'll see. We're still working on sponsorship right now. We haven't finalized anything yet, but they really want me to go, so we'll see.
That sounds great.
So Rev is kind of behind the whole operation. Will you have sponsorship on the car other than just carrying the Rev name?
Right now they said we do, but I don't know what sponsor is going to go on my car yet, so...
I gotcha.
So, Rev, yeah, they got it all figured out. So, I'm not sure what sponsor they're going to put on my car yet. So.
Gotcha.
Well, if you run out of sticker space, let me know. I'll send you a couple of small ones.
All right.
No one will notice, right?
That would be pretty cool.
Who will you go to for advice about the track or the car in general, and how many of the Canyon tracks have you been to already?
Oh, man, I think this would be the first year. I mean, the only track I'll probably know would be Houston Nurmix because they're an ARC car. But, I mean, Bristol, I mean, we got Virginia Raceway down there. I mean, we got, what else are the tracks? I'm in Iowa. Iowa's a fun track. I mean, there's only two or three tracks I've been on. Everything else is brand new to me. But my true chief would be probably the biggest one I'll go to. He's a former NASCAR race car driver, so I'll probably be hitting his head a lot, try to get information like a lot, and then probably my ARCA team, my shoot chief, try to get as much information as I can, you know, so we can do better.
Who is the crew chief?
For the Canyon Series?
Yeah, for you.
Mark Reagan.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, I just got lost track.
He got sidetracked.
Anywho, now, I know this will be a little plug for the D4D diversity thing here. What is your overall feeling with the program and since it has helped you now?
Oh, man, no, the program is an amazing program. I mean, NASCAR and then Max Eagle and then D4D, it's an amazing program. You know, this year, it was a really good choice, people that they chose this year. I mean, with Ruben, me, Allie. It was a phenomenal year. I mean, I think a lot of people were pretty excited what we can do this year. I mean, Allie, she's a really competitive race car driver. We saw that when we went to our home line. She did really good. We were proud of her. But it's going to be a good year. I mean, I think there's a lot of expectations for us. I mean, the team's strong. I mean, it's a brand new group. I mean, the only one I stay with Colin. So there's a lot of energy in the shop, and we just want to go out and get wins already.
Is Colin going to be probably the mentor for you guys now since he's been there from last year?
What's that?
I said, is Colin going to wind up being the mentor for you guys since he was there last year?
I can't hear you.
Is Colin going to be the mentor for you guys since he's been there for
a
full year now?
Oh, yeah. We're all going to be using Colin as a guide because he's been there already since last year. This will be his second year. He'll be a big guy, though. Asking a lot of questions because he's been to the track therapy, so he'll probably be the biggest guy I'll be talking to a lot, and everybody else, Ruben and Allie.
I would probably, also, if you guys could track him down, try to find Sergio Pena.
Oh, I don't know where he's at. I really don't talk to him a lot, so.
They should be able to get a hold of him through Rev Racing because they had him sub for... Oh, what's his name last year?
Beasley.
Yeah, for Jay.
Yeah,
I think he actually won a race for him.
Yeah.
Yeah, hopefully. If Speaker comes in and helps us out a lot, even more. You know, the more information you get from other drivers that race track, it's more. I mean, you'll do better and stuff and have a better reference to it.
Does Rev Racing, do you guys have an alliance for engines, chassis, and all that? Or is that any of that done in house?
I think it's Toyota. And five-star body and stuff like that, but anything else, I'm not sure. I think Toyota's a part of that, so.
Okay.
Cool. Now, how's your dad feeling about all this? I know he was having a blast when he was here with us.
Oh, so you should know how happy he is right now.
No, we wouldn't know nothing. Go ahead.
He's really excited, you know, the people that hear me opportunities and stuff like that. It was a really good year to the season last year with last Kansas Racing ARCA, finishing at 9th and then getting accepted for that racing program this year. I mean, it's looking pretty good, you know, starting 2016 on the high note, and I want to keep it that way, you know, get some wins and just do good, you know, make the people happy.
Now, what's your message out to the other young drivers that are out there that are looking to get into something like you've done?
Just to say, like, you never know who's looking. So I can probably say, well, 2 years ago, as of right now, I was about to quit. I won a championship. I got offered a Canyon ride, then an ARCA ride, and then I'm here. So you never know who's looking. You never give up. You always stay strong. Opportunities are out there. You just got to go out there and find them.
Yeah. Hey, hang on a second for me, Jay. Who's on the other line over there?
Who? Peter?
Yeah, I'm Miller.
Who's that?
I got another clean joke for you if you're ready for it.
I got another clean joke for you if you're ready.
Oh, I didn't realize you were still on the line. Somebody forgot to hang you up.
Yeah, I'm still here. What is black and white and red on the river?
Other than the youth.
Sorry, Jill.
So where it's Jay, right?
Yeah.
So Jay, where do you see yourself 5 years from now? You've gotten this great opportunity to really showcase your talent, but looking forward, what do you see 5 years down the road?
Hopefully for me, the plan, hopefully if everything goes well, you know, Carlos Zierd and Rev are really helping me out right now. Hopefully, to be in Xfinity in a couple of years, hopefully I can get some sponsorships and stuff like that, or Cup.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just depending if I can get sponsorship right now. We're really hard pushing that hard right now with me, trying to get sponsors out there and stuff. So that's been kind of a tough deal. But hopefully I can be in Cup 5 years, or hopefully make it into Xfinity.
Yeah, great. Okay. That's great.
All right. Well, anybody got any more questions for Jay?
Do you plan on doing any road racing?
Oh, yeah, you know that. I love road racing. Yeah, there's a few on the schedule. I'm like, ooh, that would be fun on the Canyon, on the east side. So hopefully I can do some on the Arkansas side. There's about two or three of them on the schedule, so it really helps a lot. But still not sure of that, so we'll see.
Cool. All right. So how's the rest of the family feel about you getting to move over here to Carolina and getting involved in all this K&M stuff?
Oh, it's good. You know, me and my mom came out here, man, because he was back home in California at work. But mom's excited. You know, we just found a place today in Kannapolis, so I'll probably be moving in next week, you know, by myself, and we're working with the team, getting the car fixed up, ready for just an airman for Speedweeks.
Somebody online wants to know, who got you involved in racing?
His friend actually was he took his son racing go-karts and stuff, and then he took me because I kind of like cars, playing with toy cars and stuff like that, and he took me one day to a class, and it turned into something big like this, so I'm standing right here.
That's
pretty neat. Me and my dad kind of laughed about that. It's kind of like emotional when we start talking about that and all the things that we've gone through and all the memories we made, so it's pretty nice I can talk about that with my dad.
So who you felt has been the neatest person you've met so far in racing?
The what?
Who's the neatest person that you feel you've met in racing?
No, there's a lot of people. I mean, there's a lot of people that have done amazing things for me. I can't just say one person, but I mean, just from going back home to the West Coast, I mean, everybody in Vegas, I'm in California, there's like I can't say one person because there's been a lot of people that helped my career, and I can't thank them enough. I wouldn't have been here without them.
So you need to send me a huge long list so I can put it at the end of the show, right?
You probably won't get it tomorrow morning if I do that.
Oh, gosh. Now, all these people that you've met with the diversity program, is there anybody that stuck out that you've met that you was sort of like on your bucket list to meet?
Like my bucket list?
Yeah, who would be on your bucket list that you wanted to meet in NASCAR that you've actually met now?
Well, I haven't met all of them yet. I'll probably be my bucket list.
So who are some of the people you got to meet and talk with?
When we went to the press release this weekend, or just in general?
In general.
Probably with Carl Edwards. I met him at, I think, was it Kansas? I talked to him for a little bit. That was awesome. He's been a really inspiration for me, just the way how he managed the Cup Series. He didn't have opportunities. He didn't get off. He worked really hard to get where he's at right now, and he's a big person that I really look up to. I met Jimmy Johnson in California a couple of years ago, down in Fontana. Kurt Busch, actually, funny story, I met Kurt Busch this past year. I was in Bakersfield in California. I'm waiting in line trying to get a burger at In-N-Out. All of a sudden, he walks in with his wife.
Samantha!
I'm looking right behind me. I'm like, that's not Kurt Busch. And I'm like, yes, it is! Dessert. So it was kind of funny. We talked a bit and stuff, so it was kind of nice.
Yeah, Al wasn't here when you were here, I don't think, was he?
No, Al wasn't here when Jay was here.
Al Pearce, he would be always asking everybody about their In-N-Out Burger experience because he loves In-N-Out Burgers.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, it was after the day after the banquet out in Vegas that I met him. It was like a Sunday or something like that. He was going back to Orange County. And I'm like, no way. And then we start talking and stuff. He's a cool dude. Him and his fiance, so.
Cool.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, let me go ahead and let you get out of here, and I'll make sure I stay up with you.
No, please do. We'll stay in contact. You guys are amazing. You guys do an amazing show. Whoa, you
have
never lose me.
we'll get you up here and get you to experience some new things too. How's that? Never know what it's going to be.
Oh, that'd be awesome. I love you learning new things.
All right, you have a good night, and we'll talk to you later, bud.
All right, you guys. Take care. Have a good night.
You too.
Night.
Bye-bye.
Good luck.
All right, bye-bye.
I thought
when the phone rang, I was already on.
I thought
it was probably going to be Dominique, so
he hit
it, and then it was just an open line, but you could hear, it sounded like there's a party going on.
That was the guy that
I know, it's the guy with the joke, I know. And, I figured that out once he said, I got another joke for you.
I was going to turn it down joke so we could, thank
Jay
you for
couldn't figure it out what was going on.
He was like, wait, what?
Yeah, there was a lot of noise blasting in once in a while, so.
Yeah. Yeah, you fooled.
Yeah.
Well, that's because you're a race car driver. You believe anything the officials tell you.
Oh, no.
It'll be so interesting I think that's what's the best experience about this is hearing names that I'm not familiar with. And so now there's a Canon race on. Now I've got somebody that I can watch.
Yeah.
There's a little logo behind you there, so don't worry about that.
Yeah.
But no, Jay, he's a really, I tell everybody I talk to, I would pick him over Kyle Larson. As far as personability and seems from the driving standpoint.
Yeah. I think it sounds
well, we'll see if he can make a mark,
Yeah. Who knows?
He sounds confident, and I know that they do have decent equipment, so if Callum can make up the other difference, I guess we'll see what happens.
If wishing it was only true, right?
Mm-hmm.
H-Cott's got 5 cars, Rev's got 6 cars, so they're usually filling up the top 10 anyway, so. Yeah.
What was the girl that was with Rev last year that's been, wasn't she getting married to one of the truck series guys?
Daniel Emmerich.
Is that what it was?
Yeah.
I don't
know. You got one more joke for you.
I don't know.
All right, let me close the show with a joke. I got to eat. I'm in Al's chair. I'm going to be Al tonight.
Yeah.
You got a joke?
Hey, guys, what do you call a 1,000 restricted plates at the bottom of the ocean?
A good place to be.
A good start.
A good start. How can you tell when a NASCAR fan is watching a Formula One race? He laps you on the shoulder and asks, are we watching qualifying? why did NASCAR outlaw the Polish victory lap? Because it was interfering with Jeff Burton's ability to finish the race.
Oh, man.
That was
fan.
That was pretty rough.
What's the difference between Tony Stewart's car and a porcupine? On a porcupine, the friction on the outside.
Oh, down. Messing with my boy now. You have to hang up on him now.
I'm sorry, guys.
That's all right.
That was a good one, too, though.
I've got nice, tough skin. It ain't going to bother me. Tony would laugh at that, by the way.
Yeah, he would. It's,
unless it was after the race.
Yeah.
His sense of humor is worn out by then.
What does Britney Spears and Dale Earnhardt Jr. have in common?
What was that one?
Wait a minute. He said Britney Spears and Dale Jr., what do they have in common? What was the punchline?
They both blow rides.
Oh, God. Oh, I was going to tell you, Tony would have probably told you that the porcupine would probably run from him.
All right, guys. Appreciate it.
All right, have a good one. Now we got it.
That'd be a good feature. It's kind of like Larry the Cable Guy calling
the
show.
Speaking of
give me 5 minutes to tell his little joke book, run down it.
Anywho.
Any snow out there?
The other thing too that we like and I like to do, I like to get the new kids coming up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's neat to also get some people. We're going to have one of our next shows, possibly next week or the week after, a guy that is bringing in a new type of Hans device.
Oh, is he going to bring it in to show
No,
like
he'll
like
be
a
calling
mock-up?
In.
Oh.
Maybe he can send us one. I don't know.
Well, you'll have one posted up there.
Yeah, it'll be a picture up there anyway.
And so, what's the improvement?
Well, it's an all-in-one unit, sits on you, you don't have to hook it up to anything, and it's more like a cervical collar.
So you don't hook it to the helmet this time?
Nope.
That'll feel weird.
So, supposedly,
I have to
pull it up or post it somewhere so you can see it,
yeah.
Picture of it.
What's the guy's name? Yeah.
I can't see my computer from here. I just know I've got somebody.
All right.
That'd be interesting.
But, like we had one lady called in one time and she did most of the window nets for the NASCAR drivers.
Oh yeah.
For their cup.
There you go.
Xfinity Truck Series. And there was a lot. She had a lot of neat stories too. Mm-hmm. Those are always nice people to get. Is people that are off. My buddy that does the Wiley X.
Hey, now there's somebody you need to have on and see if he can. Get everybody on the show a pair of glasses.
I already did that once.
Oh, well, do it again, because I wasn't here then.
Get me some Wiley X glasses.
Yeah, I was saying, you know, we'll all wear them during
the
show. We'll be happy to.
Show.
We'll set them right on top of our head, make sure they're always permanently placed.
Yeah. They'll break Al's rule.
Jack and Scott were here. Yeah. We got three pairs set to us.
Hey, we'll break Al's rule. We'll wear sunglasses during the
Get
interview.
Somebody from Jack Daniels on the show as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Send us a little something to set right here.
Get somebody from
Anheuser. Send us a sampler kit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Get somebody from Anheuser.
We need a prop, you know, so if you don't mind, send us over something.
Oh, gosh. We're getting too wild and crazy
and
here.
Fill it back with tea, I guess.
You can tell we're getting hungry now.
You'll never know.
You're going to get her all wound up, too.
No.
She's
got to
get
home
and call Domino's. What are you talking about?
No, grilled ham and cheese sandwiches.
Grilled ham and cheese sandwiches.
No soup, just sandwich.
Sandwich.
Y'all feel like a pizza for once? We haven't had a pizza.
Why not?
Before.
Yeah, I'm all for it.
See, you should go with us. It's right here local, Rico's.
No.
You can take them a pizza for the
way. Yeah, you better take them. We'll order their biggest one they have, like it's like this big around, and we'll just eat half and you can take the rest of it back. They'll be set. You won't have to cook anything.
I know. I hate to be a snob, but I lived in it.
Now, can you imagine that?
Snob!
They ate, what did you say they ate at 5 o'clock or something?
Yeah,
what were they eating?
Cinnamon roll. They had a cinnamon
roll.
Oh,
yeah. Can you imagine trying to survive this long
on
just a cinnamon roll?
Yeah, no.
Oh, that's right. You said that earlier. I was going to tell you, we had a phone call that started up. There's a new donut place down, you know where the new Old Point Bank is?
Mm-hmm.
National Bank is?
Yep.
Hampton?
Yep.
Yeah.
Go through the drive-thru as you're looking straight ahead.
Someone was telling me that. New
donut
place.
Oh, yeah. I've seen it.
When we get done, stop. Unless Lamont's already stolen them or eating them up, the donuts are like this freaking big, regular glazed donuts.
Really?
Not cake donuts.
Freaking meal
on
its own.
Oh.
Yeah.
Not cake donuts.
They have cake donuts, too.
Okay. I like cake donuts.
Okay. All right, let's do a wrap-up so we can get out of here.
All right, well, if Tony Stewart don't get in the fight again this week, we'll...
He might be able to race if they come.
We'll be back next week.
Oh, gosh. Don't get me started now. Oh, let me go ahead and shut down this part here. That one actually worked decent for once. Well, 52 people watched.
I thought you were supposed to say... thank you guys for tuning in to Let's Talk Racing.
I ain't done with the stream.
Well,
we can still do that. Everybody will catch
the Periscope people, the heck with y'all.
They got the early 15-minute session. So everybody here will just get the rest of the junk we throw out there. Anyway, we'll catch everybody next week on Let's Talk Racing. See you, everybody. Bye.
Yeah.